Ashhadu anna kullu rasul rasulullah, ashhadu anna Muhammad rasulullah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. In the name of Allah, most gracious and most merciful. In the name of the Almighty God, the beneficent and the merciful. We give praise and thanks to God for bringing us together so that we may worship Him in spirit and in truth. And so I reach out and greet all my brothers and sisters of different denominations. To my Christian brothers and sisters, peace be unto you. To my Hindu brothers and sisters, namaste. To my Rastafarian brothers and sisters, Jah peace and Jah love. To my Muslim brothers and sisters and all other denominations, peace be unto you in the Arabic language. Assalamu alaikum. We are still in the second week of fasting in this month of Ramadan. And I would like to recognize some of the ills of our society that is very important as we fast in this particular period. One of the things that we have seen and observed in our society, and we are criticizing, is the wayward ways of our children. More and more we hear complaints about how our children are behaving and the attitude that children have got, not only to parents, but to older and elderly people. Our children are not aware of the fact that people who are older or as old as their parents represent their parents in the society. In this month of Ramadan, it is a theme that we need to look at. In our society, we are accustomed to celebrating Father's Day, Mother's Day, Grandfather's Day, Grandmother's Day. We celebrate these things, and our children do not seem to understand the underlying foundation for these particular days. It is all right to give presents and gifts to our grandmothers and our mothers and our fathers when we are having these different days. These different days have never been prescribed in the Quran, in the Bible, neither in the Bhagavad Gita, the three main religions of our society. And God knows why He hasn't prescribed or decreed a specific day for that. It is therefore important, because what God has prescribed is, in the Quran it is said, we have enjoined on man kindness to parents. We have enjoined on man kindness to parents. The Bible says, honor thy mother and thy father. The Bhagavad Gita tells us about coming out of the Vedic philosophy, the Vedic scriptures, how we are supposed to treat our parents. We see that, for example, especially by the Hindus, we see during their wedding ceremonies what an important role the father has in giving away his daughter, what an important role the mother has in accepting her son-in-law. And so we understand that there is a demand in our scriptures that children respect their parents. One of the things that we have seen is how children are able to divide their parents. And it is something that is responsible and that has contributed to the waywardness of the children of our society in this time of our lives. The importance of parents sticking together, holding one head together, respecting the rules and regulations that parents are supposed to respect against the waywardness of their children, that is something that we need to understand. Because of children being able to divide their parents, to have one parent against the other one, to have one parent keep secrets for them against the other one. You know, these things have contributed to what we have and what we are experiencing in our society. Many times things happen to our children and one parent knows about it. The father knows, but the mother don't know. The mother knows, but the father doesn't know. And then when it happens, when it becomes to the point and the head where there is problems and trials and tribulations, then eventually it ends up that the parent that didn't know must still have to reach out a hand to help, even though it was kept from him or kept from her. This attitude, this concept, this philosophy is contributing to the disrespect that children have now developed for their parents. Parents, on the other hand, have got to understand that they are not children. They have to understand that, regardless of what I hear, at times I hear that children are saying, my mother is my best friend. My father is my best friend. There is no friendship when it comes to parents and children. We have to be able to look at our children as children, and the parents have got to look to their children as children. Now, God, in his wisdom, at no time did God tell us that we should love our parents. At no time did God decide to bring us to the point where we are saying we should love our parents. We were never told that we should love our parents. We were told that we should honor our parents. We should honor our mother and fathers, not that we should love them. If I deal with the Christian concept of their religious philosophy, then we see that God said, honor thy mother and thy father. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. This is the only time that God spoke anything about love. When it comes to children, we were never told we must love our children. Our children were never told that they must love their parents. But we must honor our mother and our father. Honor is the word, not love. But we have a society today where parents love their children, or claim to love their children, and because of that, they allow themselves to be entangled and entwined in all kinds of aspects of their children's life. And so children use and abuse their parents' so-called love. Why did God take it upon himself to tell us we should love him and love our neighbors? Why didn't he find other people for us to love? Love our neighbor as ourselves and love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul. Now that is something else that we have to question when we are told, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul. That is something that seems quite impossible for the human being to do or to commit themselves to. Because all our heart and all our soul, it's a very difficult situation to put ourselves in. And many times we find that we love our children, we love our husbands, we love our wives more with our heart and our soul than we love our Creator. The Quran says, and remember when we made a covenant with the children of Israel, worship none save Allah and be good to your parents. This is what has broken down in our society. Children who claim to love their parents are not good to their parents. Mother's Day, Father's Day, yes, they bring presents, they bring gifts, they write nice cards, but then they live their lives in accordance with what they feel, with what they want, with what they think, and what they would like to achieve. We should, especially in this month of Ramadan, these are things we need to reflect on. Like I said before, that the month of Ramadan is no different to the month of Lent. It's no different to the month of Nowrat for the Hindus. It's no different. It's just the same aspect and philosophy of us being able to fast, to pray, and to give recognition to our Creator. For there is no doubt that we have a Creator. This Creator has been given to us with a name or with names. Our Creator has a world of names, different names. And whatever names we call this Creator, we must be cognizant of the fact that we have a Creator, we were created. Anything that was made has a maker, and we were made, therefore we have a maker. And this maker we respect and call God. And it is this God that we turn to when we are in problems, when we are in trouble. You see, here we have it again, that many times our children and our parents, they have no time to worship God as it was intended or as it was advised, because the worldly things, the things of the world, the nice music, the nice drugs, the nice dresses and clothes and things that attract us, they mean so much to us that we have no time to consider our Creator and our Maker. But when we get ill, when we get sick, That's the time when we the worldly things don't mean anything anymore. You have people who are accustomed to partying, having a good time. And when they get sick, you say, man, let's go to a party. They say, no, I don't feel good. I don't feel like going. There's a nice set of clothes that have now come into the country. People are buying it. Don't you want? No, I'm not interested. All of a sudden, we don't become interested in these things anymore when we get sick. And I can't help emphasizing on that, that we wait until we are sick, and we wait until we are diseased. Some of us wait until we are even in a state of dying before we decide to give up the worldly things, to give up the things that we believe are so important to us. How many children give up their parents? How many parents give up their children? In a country like Guyana, for example, where there is not even a million people, as we are told.
Man creates his own monster. Weapons of damnation and disaster. No sign at all of human rights. The day has turned into night. Is racialism so? And segregation so? Which way?
We have an orphanages. We have a quantity of orphanages in this country that are full with homeless children. Why? Parents have given them up. Parents who have so many excuses to give up their children. Children who claim that they love their parents, but they have no time for them. They have time for everything else. And when problems hit them, when things happen to them, they turn around and they go turn to these same parents that they have deserted and they have treated as if they are strangers. But children must understand that all elderly people in this society are their parents. You see, we have a way of just looking at our blood relatives as if they mean so much. There are people who I know who have been brought up by elderly people who are not their blood relatives. And they were treated, who have been given up by their blood relatives, orphans, and who have been treated in a hospitable manner by other people who are not their relatives. The Prophet Muhammad is an example of an orphan. A man who was brought up without mother and without father, and who has made an impact on the world. I remember Jesus being at a wedding. Story in the Bible where Jesus was at a wedding, and they came to him and they said to him, Master, your mother and your brethren are looking for you. And he says, my mother and my brethren are those who do my father's work. What he's showing us there is the fact that it's not just always your blood relatives that must be counted as close, as being close to you. When we hear love thy neighbor as thyself, who is God speaking about? You know, our first neighbors are our parents. Our first neighbors are our children. We call them parents, but they are our neighbors. They live next to us. We are born next to them. Those are our first neighbors. And if we don't love our parents like we love ourselves, we don't love our neighbors like we love ourselves. Many times when we hear about neighbors, we believe that it's the neighbor living next door. That's a different kind of neighbor. Our neighbors are those who have helped to bring us up. those who have fed us, those who have given us a good word, those who have cleaned us when we were dirty. Our teachers are our neighbors. Those whom we go to school, our teachers that try to correct us, that try to tell us things that are necessary for our lives, those are our neighbors. But we don't seem to realize that when God says, love thy neighbor as thyself, it's the one neighbor means the one near to you, the nearest ones to you. No, we don't have time for that. We love ourselves so much that we have no time to love anyone else. And our religions keep insisting and telling us things that they don't really explain to us. And so we continue to do what we feel to do, how we feel to do it, in the eyes of Almighty God. Brothers and sisters, you know, we have so much to blame, ourselves to blame. I hear it every time in this country. The children of today are not like the children of yesterday. What is the difference? Why are the children? Because who are the parents of the children of today? We were the children of yesterday. And we are the parents of the children today. So why are we saying that we, as the children of yesterday, knew how to behave and to respect our parents better than the children today respect us? Why? Whose fault is it? It is our fault. How come we were better children yesterday than the children that we ourselves produce today? Because we have relaxed. I don't want to treat my child like that because, you know, I was treated like that. I don't want to be so to my son or to my daughter. You know how my mother was to me. How my mother and my father was to me, it's what I am today. And I am thankful for the things and the disciplines that my parents gave to me. And I have to stick to the same rule and regulation that made me today what I am. You see, I have to keep that. I am not going to stray away from that. I'm not going to distance myself from that, regardless of who likes it and who doesn't like it. When my father says to me, sit, I sit. Even if I feel that my father isn't right in what he's saying to me, I used to sit. And today I'm glad that I used to sit. When my mother take up anything and hit me with it, I never used to like it. But I'm glad today that she used to hit me because of her love for me. She wanted what she figured was best for me. Today we have all kinds of things. Child abuse, if you speak to your child in a certain way, if you give your child a few lashes, it's child abuse. If the teacher, you know, we used to get licks in school, discipline, corporal punishment. And you know, if we read the scriptures, we will find that God is also a God of punishment. It's a lot of punishment. Read some of the things that God has prescribed, you know? Read some of the laws that Moses brought. There are laws that's dealing with punishment. Punishment can be fatal, and I'm not speaking about fatal punishment, and punishment can be correct. It's a matter of correction. I remember in school, when I do anything, I used to be told, come for six of the best, either in the palm of my hands or on my bottom. Six of the best. And many of us got six of the best. And today, those of us who have received six of the best, today we have no regrets in having to undergo some of the punishment that we were given. Our children today are not being punished in ways that needs to be. And like I say, parents are responsible. We, the parents, are responsible for the behavior and the attitude of our children. And we allow our children to divide us. See, our children today are able to play the mother against the father, play the father against the mother, and these kinds of things go on. But those of us parents who know to themselves what we are supposed to do, yeah? My mother and my father are those who do my father's work. That's what Jesus said. And that's what we should say about our children. Our children are those who are prepared to do our father's work, who are prepared to respect the Creator, who are prepared to respect the God that we believe in. You can't disrespect your parents and respect God. It doesn't work. Once you disrespect your parents, you disrespect your Creator. For parents are part of you, of your life, and everything that belongs to you. And therefore, we need to understand that. We are told again, there is a part in the Bible where we are told, do not spare the rod and spoil the child. These are things that God told us. Moses told us an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You know? And so we must understand that those laws are still existing today. And we have taken examples and rules and regulations from other societies who feel to themselves that they are in a position to regulate the lives of their children in a different manner than God has prescribed that it should be. We look at the stars, you know, the film stars. I call them, some of them, the moon stars, you know. We look at them, and they are supposed to be an example. Look at some of the female stars, how many times they have been married. We have, I don't want to call any names, we have one of them who was a famous film star. She was a child star. She had 9 husbands, you know, and yet still she's portrayed as a person who is an example, or who should be an example for our daughters. Huh? We have male and female people who we see on television every day, who are shown to us, who are supposed to be famous people, who behave as animals, cats and dogs. They divorces, they fight among themselves, and they are the examples that our children are shown. Our children can go on the internet. Today, they have this thing, Facebook. You look at Facebook. Huh? One of the most dirtiest books in the world is Facebook. It is so dirty. It has all the nastiness on it. And yet still, many of us are proud to put their faces on Facebook. Huh? We didn't have Facebook when we were growing up. We had to keep our faces clean so that our books will be read in a clean manner, because your face is a book, you know. Your behavior is a book. Our attitudes, they are all books. We don't need that kind of Facebook, but it has become famous. So Facebook is where we go and read and put all the dirty things that are possible. I'm not saying that there are not some good things on Facebook as well, but when you really get down to the nitty-gritty and understand what Facebook is all about, and you see what is there, And you sometimes go on Facebook, and when you go on Facebook, you see your daughter. You go on Facebook, you see your son. You don't even know that they are there. Somebody says, hey man, I saw your son on Facebook, man. I saw your daughter on Facebook, right? And then they, since they can't be stars, since they can't act in movies like the film star, then they act on Facebook. They do all the things on Facebook so that the world will see them like the world sees the face, the famous ones on Facebook. So I want to instill in those who are hearing and who are listening that in this particular month, especially to the Muslims, in this particular month, we need to look at the attitude that we as parents have to our children. And our children need to look at the attitude that they have to us as parents. And we need to be truthful to ourselves and let ourselves know that the blame that we are putting on our children today is because we, the parents, have contributed to the behavior of those children that we call wayward and uncontrollable in our society today. We have strayed away from the training, from the disciplines that our parents gave to us. And we have decided that we are going to make things better and lighter for our children. And the result is what we are seeing there. Murderers, killers, thieves, prostitutes, homosexuals, all kinds of things, because we have lightened up on the discipline that we are supposed to give to our children. So in this month, while we fast and while we pray, let us ask God for guidance so that we may be able to guide not only our children, but our grandchildren, because the children of today are the parents of tomorrow. And if we have allowed our children to be what they are today, what are going to be the result of the children that they are going to make? Right now we have children who are parents. We have 13-year-old girls, 14-year-old girls who are mothers. And those girls have been brought up by our generation. And so they have become mothers at such a young age. They know not what to do. And so they know not how to train and discipline their children that they are having. See, we have a way too, you know, if you notice it today, children have a way of making children and then bringing it and giving it to their parents. Parents who have raised 5 and 6 children, and their children have now become big, and they have gone with their wayward ways and have made other children, and they bring them and give them to the grandparents. So here are a set of parents who have made children and now are now bringing up another generation of children. We must also remember that it is a burden on our parents to do that. It's a burden for the years that we have taken as parents to look after you, to train you, to feed you. It has taken a lot out of us. And if you love your parents, you will not go now and make children and bring your children and give them to your parents who have suffered with you for so long. You can't love your parents. And that is why God didn't say to love them. He says honor them. That's all God said. Honor your mother and your father, not love them. And God, in his wisdom, knows why he said that. God knows why he didn't tell us to love our parents, because God knows we cannot love our parents. We are in no position to love them. The things that we do. You know, if you look at the certain things that people do with their husbands and wives, how they treat their husbands and wives, and how they treat their parents. Many men love their wives more than their parents. Many Women love their husbands more than their parents, their boyfriends and their girlfriends more than their parents. And that is why God knows in his wisdom. And he says, don't worry to love them. Just honor them. That's all we want you to do. Honor your mother and your father. And even that is difficult for them. Sisters, I want to thank you very much for listening to me. I want to thank you for coming, for taking time out in this special month of the year. And may Allah bless you and guide you and keep you until we meet again. I want to wish you all a blessed Ramadan, and may Almighty God grant you all the things that you expect or wish for your lives in this new year. Assalamu alaikum.
Is a whole big run around. A lot of talk is what goes on. While the world is left to mourn, starvation taking toll, weapons out of control, the atmosphere is cold, oh, so cold. Oh Lord, tell me, what about love thy neighbor? Tell me, what about he and Terry? He's my brother. Nobody cares a damn anymore. World day pattern, their mind is war. War. Tell me, what about equal rights and justice? Tell me, what about peace and happiness? Da 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 da. Hey. Making new laws every day, and those of the master they try.